All right. Today we begin chapter 7. Risk and return. We already discussed quite a few times in the previous chapters about return. You had to make a lot of calculations related to return. Now we are coming to the more important subject of risk itself. First of all, is we need to find out, number one, what is risk? And then the second basic idea is how to measure it. And actually the measurement turns out to be relatively simple, even if it's incorrect. So, number one, what is risk? Well, let's take two assets. Number one moves like this. Okay, that's number one asset. And number two asset moves like this. Okay, so this is asset A, this is asset B. Okay, asset A is high risk, and asset B is low risk. Risk is not simply measured by how much the price can go down. This is called downside risk. Downside risk is how much an asset can actually fall. But the more general measure of risk includes upside risk. It's actually upside potential. So the upside is like the return part, and the downside is like the risk part. But in general, we look at the variability. Variability. If the price varies a lot, it is a high risk. And if the price varies very little, it's a low risk. It's very simple as that. Also, do not get confused that one of them, for example, goes up a lot, and the other one goes very little. Obviously, this is again relatively high risk, and obviously this is relatively low risk. Again, it's the variability part. There is a big range of movement from the up to the down, or from the down to the up. Here, the movement is small. From the up to the down, it's almost nothing. Okay? So this represents fairly small risk, and this represents fairly high risk. Next one, so that you don't confuse the risk with return, here's another picture. There's an asset which goes a lot like this, and the other asset goes like this. Again, this is the high risk, and this is the low risk. Do not confuse the negative return with high risk. Just because it's falling doesn't mean that it is risky. Look, both of them are risky. But this is lower risk, and this is higher risk. Actually, you may expect, and it's perfectly normal to expect, to have an asset that will have a high risk to give you a relatively much higher return. And on the other side, you may have a low risk asset, and it may actually even give you a little bit of a negative return. And that can happen a lot with bonds. Bonds may be oftentimes relatively low risk, and they may give you slight negative return. Or you may have bonds, they may be on a picture almost flat. They don't give you any gain, and they don't give you any loss. The price is almost the same. Of course, they may be 0.1% or 0.05%. It's virtually nothing from top to bottom. So this is the low risk. Similarly, you can add some growth. Let's add some growth. Here is the one asset, which is very low risk, okay? And here is another asset, which is high risk, and this is low risk, okay? And finally, you may have something which has no risk. And again, it may have a trend line, it may not have a trend line. No risk is just plain flat line. That's it, that's no risk. Or it may be moving up. This is also an asset with zero risk. Once you remove the trend, there is no variability. As long as you expect the asset to give you a straight line, for example, you may have some sort of a guaranteed payment, it may have literally zero risk. Now, in investments in the real world, you don't get zero risk because there are other problems like inflation risk. Which is the risk that money loses purchasing power. So you're guaranteed, let's say 6 weeks from now, you're gonna get $1,000 for sure, guaranteed. But you have no idea within 6 weeks how much money, how much it will buy. Especially if it's a longer term investment. Within 2 or 3 years, money can lose value a lot. You may get 20, 30, 40% inflation, and money can lose 20, 30, 40% of its value. You may have similarly, and related to inflation risk, is currency risk. Someone may promise you 1 year from now, 1 million riel. And that will be what, $25,000? What is it gonna be, $25,000? Huh? 1 million.
$250.
So someone will promise you 1 million real, and today it's equal to $250. And the promise is 1 year from now guaranteed by the government and whatever the story is, you know, insured by a bank and backed by, let's say, real estate. You're pretty guaranteed you're going to get those $250. I mean, 1 million real. But you're not guaranteed that 1 year from now it's going to be $250, okay? It may be actually buying a whole lot less, all right? So you may be able to buy with 3,000 real, let's say you can buy coffee today, but a year from now might not be enough to buy coffee, okay? Or Coke, or Pepsi, or coconuts, okay? So again, that's inflation risk and currency risk. You always have it. So here we talk risk in terms of two things. One is just called a price risk. This will be the price of a stock. Again, price risk. The price of a stock, the price of a bond, the price of real estate, the price of a commodity. Now, commodity could be the price of rice, you're all familiar with. The price of oil. And of course, we always put in gold as the most important commodity. Remember why it was important? Or the, why it's the most important commodity, gold? The most important commodity of all commodities. Or why it's the most important financial asset, more important than stock or bonds.
Because it's stable.
No, it's a little different answer. Because it is both at the same time. Gold is the only asset which is real asset, has a value of its own, and a financial asset used for payments. So, gold is the connection between financial assets and real assets. Alright, so, any asset, sometimes price risk, may be also called, but this is very unclear term, asset risk. Of course, we refer to the price of the asset. So, whether it's a rice or a stock or a bond, the price, as long as it varies and zigzags, is a risk. The bigger the zigzag, the bigger the risk. Okay, we call this variability. Okay, variability. And how is variability measured? It's measured with STD, which is the standard deviation. And the standard deviation sometimes is designated as sigma. And every software has built-in standard deviation. Excel has built-in standard deviation. So that's why I'm saying is back in the old days, volatility and standard deviation was very difficult to calculate before there were calculators, before the world of Excel. But you were born with Excel and calculators, so now life is infinitely easier, okay? Also, back in the old days, you just, to make the calculation easy, you'll just take a few monthly observations or monthly prices and do it on a monthly basis. You're gonna calculate, let's say for 1 year, you're just gonna take 12 prices. Now you can get 250 prices. And or better, you can even get hourly data. And based on the hourly data, you could make the calculation of the of this. Now, going back to the midterm that you had to make in problem four, the return of Dow Jones from 14,000 going up to 20,000, which was like 4.04%. And then for gold, getting the price from, what was it, 800 or I don't remember, to 1200, it was again about 4.11%. And again, you cannot say which was a better investment. Now, let's get back to that subject, not part of this course. When you look at an investment, you gotta look at the return and you have to look at the risk. Investment can be judged and must be judged only by looking at the both at the same time. You can't only look at the return and say, oh, this was a better investment. We can say, yes, gold had slightly better return, okay? But we can't say it was a better investment. Now, we can take the risk of gold, we can take the risk of Dow Jones, and if gold had a lower risk, in this case we'll mean lower price variability and lower measured by the standard deviation, and at the same time gave you a higher return, then you can say, yes, gold is a better investment, both because it gave you a better return and for a lower risk. Now, at the same time, real estate may be even better, even if it gives you only 3% return, but with very little steady variability, okay? Or in that particular period, depends on how you choose the period, it may be that bonds gave you only 2 or 3%, but it was almost like a straight line. So bonds couldn't possibly give you even lower risk. Now, it's important to understand the next basic thing is that risk can change in the following sense. You may have a bond and the price could be very, very, very stable. And then something changes. Something in the economy changes. For example, between the United States and Russia, you may get a trade war, like the president changes. And now Donald Trump talks really bad about China and China's trade policies. He doesn't like them. He will punish China. Whatever the story is. So politics change. And now there is a huge volatility in Chinese bonds. Well, here is something equally interesting. This is not, doesn't apply to China. President Trump is expected, he says, he talks, and that was part of his initial pre-election talk, that he will do a lot of fiscal stimulus. In other words, he's going to spend a lot of money which America does not have. Well, how do you spend money which you don't have? You borrow. So he is promising to borrow a lot more money and to spend it, and there may be a good return on that money spent. Usually, most of the money is just wasted with little return. That's what governments do, okay? So there is a significant increase in the risk of US government bonds after the election, and the government bonds are a lot more volatile. Of course, risk changes probably in a couple of hours or days if there's a war or if there's a terrorist attack, okay? So the risk can change because of politics, it can change because of geopolitics, it can change because of economy. For example, if you're a small country that exports oil and suddenly your main oil well or oil pipeline blows up, obviously the risk for the economy increases. The risk for the stocks increases, the risk for the bonds increases. So you should not think that risk is static and that risk is the same. Risk can increase and risk can decrease. Now, there's one other type of increase in risk, which textbooks never talk about, but at least you need to understand, is that, for example, real estate can go very fast, and it's perfectly steady, very little volatility. But the faster it goes, the bigger becomes the risk of a crash. Or it can go further and crash further. This is known as another type of risk. It's not really in the textbook. It's called reversion to the mean. If the normal, natural, inflation-adjusted, let's say, growth for the price is this, and this is the natural one, and your real estate may be starting a lot lower, it grows a lot faster. If it crashes off this level, it's going to be a small, tiny little crash. If it crashes off this level, it may be a tiny, a little bigger, but still a small. If it crashes off this, it could be a huge, huge fall. Now, there is a chance, as we solve one problem in Japan, that it may not crash. It may just fall steady, 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 and it can go like for 20 years. In Japan, real estate is going like this for about 25 years, and it falls very little, okay? But it's falling for a long, 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 25 years long time. Imagine you're 30 years old in Japan, you bought an overpriced apartment, and at the age of 55, and it's only half the price. And you will never live in your life, if you live like the average Japanese 8 years old, to see the price that you paid back. Okay, you might not see it for a, you may never live to see that. So, this gives you a higher downfall risk, okay? Well, this particular risk, the asset is a lot higher than its regular natural price. We'll call this overvaluation risk. The longer and the faster it rises on the upfront, the bigger is the risk of a horrible crash, which again may come hard, may come relatively slow, or maybe very easy. Again, the investor will experience the pain. The question is the pain 50% in 1 year, or let's say 15% in 3 or 4 years, or is it 3% in 25 years? It's a different type of pain, okay? And it's a different type of, in other words, when I say risk, because I kept using this over and over, risk for investors mean pain. It causes pain and suffering. With that introduction, I can move on to the real job of beginning to follow a little bit about the textbook. So, section number one is about realized. And we already did realized returns many times. Now we're going to add a little extra piece, the piece of income. For example, you bought a house and the house was $100,000, okay? Then the house went to $101,000 after 1 year. And if this was the investment, you made a 1% return. But you may have additionally, so this is the price, you may have additionally rent. And if you are able to rent it for $2,000, you effectively got from an investment of 100, you got 103. And the 103 gives you a 3% return. All right? So how do we calculate the return? Very easy. You take the difference between the new price and the old price. The new price we call P1, price in period 1, okay? Then you subtract the price in period 0, which is the initial price or the purchase price, okay? And then you simply divide by the original price, okay? So this is just the prices. And now comes the new piece. You add, we can say, income. Okay, you just add the income for the year. Now, this formula assumes that income comes at the end of the period. for the calculation. The income comes at the end of the period. If the income comes at the beginning, you just add it at the purchase price or subtract it from the purchase price, depending whether you paid for it or you didn't pay for it. So income, if it's at the beginning, you adjust the P0. If it's at the end, you will add it to your return. Okay? Now, I actually made a slight mistake, and I will clarify that part. That's just basic finance. It's a habit. Here is the notice now, the trick. Please pay attention. We call the return this part. This is the return. The return is $3,000. This is the increase in price plus income. When you divide by P0, you get, it's called rate of return. In other words, the return is how much you got, and the rate of return gives you the percentage. So the rate gives you the percentage. So that's an important. And again, when we do return, like some of you, you may write the return to be 0.0411. That was like the return on gold that you guys calculated. Or you can do it like 4.11%. Okay? We prefer when we get returns to keep them in or convert them in percentages. It's just more common sense. This is correct and this is also correct, but it's a little, this is more the preferred way. So you add the income. The income, I'll repeat, will be the following. I already wrote it, I'll write it again. The income will be, for a stock, will be, how do we call it?
Dividend.
Let's write it out. Dividend. This is the income of stock investors, the return on stock. If it's a bond, we call it
coupon.
Correct. Sometimes they call it interest. If it's real estate, the income is called? Rent. That was easy, right? Now, if it's a deposit in the bank, just a deposit in the bank, it would be, or if it's in general, let's clarify. In general, if it's a currency, whether it's a Swiss franc or a Swedish kroner or whatever dollar deposit, you just call it interest. If you invested, let's say, in Swiss kroner or Japanese yen, you get the interest. Okay? So this is the income part. And now this, so that's the income part. Now the P1 minus P0 tells you how much the asset price went up. How we call this part?
Inflation.
Well, inflation is a general increase in the price level. Or more correctly, if you remember, is a general increase in the supply of money, which is the cause, which results in a general increase. Everything's going up. Coffee, tea, phones, everything, that's inflation. Now, when you bought an investment, whether it's a stock or a bond or real estate, gold or rice, and the price went up, how we call this? Yes, it's a capital gain here. Okay, let's do the capital gain second. It's called appreciation. appreciation. Appreciation is an increase in the value of an asset.
Okay.
Now, if the asset value fell, in other words, if the price falls down, we call it depreciation. Now we're observing over the last 12 months, depreciation of the Chinese currency. Okay, the Chinese yuan is depreciation, meaning falling in value. The value of a currency is measured by the exchange rate. Alright, so appreciation, so this part is called the appreciation. Now we need to clarify the capital gain. Capital gain is if you actually sold the asset and if you actually realized the gain. So the appreciation is basically the increase in the value. The capital gain is if you actually realized, if you actually sold it, okay? So capital gain is after you sell, after you realize. And sometimes it's called realized capital gain. And sometimes they'll say realized appreciation. So the word in, now this is an investment. The word realized means you actually sold your investment and you cashed in your profits. Okay? You sold it, you realized your profit, it's in your pocket. Okay? That's the best kind of profit. Or the best kind of, in this particular case, we say gain, realized. Now, if it's going up, 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 and up, the appreciation has a nice name. It's a slang, but everyone in finance and in Wall Street understands this is capital gain. This is called paper gain. Paper gain. In other words, this is a gain on paper. Meaning it's not in your pocket, it's not realized, okay? So your house went from 100 to 110, okay? So you have a paper gain of $10,000, okay? Maybe you will realize it, maybe you will not, okay? If it's a risk, it's still paper gain. You're still investing. And of course you may have a paper loss. Alright, so you have the next concept is called holding period. And that's fairly straightforward. Students understand very easily. Gold and Dow Jones that I gave you was from 2007 till the end of 2016. So we say this period is called the holding period. Holding period is a period of time where at the beginning you purchase the asset and at the end you sell the asset. Okay, it's holding period. So holding period is like in this particular case is 9 years. Is the length of time during which you hold an asset, during which you hold a stock, a bond, in general, an investment, any investment. Could be house, of course. So that's the holding period. I already covered rate of return. That's page, rate of return, that's page 212. The holding period is again page 212. Let's see what else I got. You may have, and you did calculations of negative rates of return. Okay, one of your problems was actually asking you to calculate negative rates of return, and I will cover it's section three. It is section three. You two guys, hey guys. All right, front desk, okay? One of you, front desk. Is, maybe you remember, how did we do this? We said return was plus 15%. I'm talking about the midterm exam, the very first problem. And then it was minus 15%. Then it was plus 10%. And then minus 10%. Remember that part? Well, that's problem number one. Now, let's see, and now I'm jumping just a little bit to section three, but we did this already in class, we did it before. So, if it's 15, and all you needed to do was to take $1,000, and these are the sequential returns. Well, if it's 1,000, now this will be 115, okay, plus 15. The next return, so you're going to get $1,000 times 115. That's period zero. This will be in period one. Now, you get minus 15. Minus 15 is 0.85. So, now this is year two. Plus 10 is going to be 1.10. Okay. And the next one is going to be 0.90. Okay. So this we call compound return. Because we were doing compounding, I expected all of you to give me the compound return. This is the only proper and correct way to do the return. You have also average return. And the average return is plus 15, minus 15, plus 10, minus 10. You just add them up, which gives you zero. So it becomes plus 15%, minus 15%, ... average zero, okay? Well, that's the average return, okay? But remember, if you actually invested $1,000 upfront, and first you got the plus 15, then the minus 15, then the plus 10, then the minus 10, you're gonna end up out of $1,000, you're gonna end up with, what was the average return? Anyone who did it correctly? It was like minus 1%. No, minus 0.83. The actual answer was minus 0.83 or 82. Some people got 0.79, I saw, that's just as good. So let's just say, roughly, minus 1%. Over the course of 4 years, you lost roughly 4% of your money. Even though it was averaging to zero, you lost 4%. Well, how much is 4%? It's like you lost $4. So you ended up with $960. So you begin with 1,000, you end up with 960. Well, sorry, that's a 4% loss, okay? Now, loss gives you a negative return, okay? A negative return. So that's the next one, which is on the next page, negative rate of return. You convert negative rates of return usually by multiplying with 1, you subtract the negative rate of return. So, a negative rate of return of minus 1% will be 0.99. Okay? a negative rate of return of 3% is going to be 0.97. A negative rate of return of 20% is going to be 0.8. And a negative rate of return of 50% is going to be 0.5. Now, a positive rate of return of 12% is going to be 1/12. And a negative rate of return of 12% is going to be 0.88. Okay. So that's very straightforward. Let's see what else we got. Calculating the expected rate of return. All right, next one. This is the average return. This average return, based on past data, is called historic return. Historic return. So, all we've been doing in all of the problems that we solved, we did historic returns. What I tried in all of these problems to give you, and those problems that you got on the midterm, they were actual numbers, actual returns, what the prices were of Dow Jones and of gold, and what were the actual returns on the pension funds. So we actually have to calculate the historic returns. Well, you may get an expected return. And the expected return, you have a number of ways of doing it. Number one is you do probability, and number two, you do what I wrote there, the average historic return. Number two is easy, like super easy. Yes, it was giving you 1%, 2%, 2%, 3%, okay? And let's throw in one more. 1, 2, 2, 5, 3, 2%. What's the average? Historic average is 1, 2, 2 is 5. And 5, 10. So it's 10% over 5 years is 2%. This is the average historic return of the last average over the last 5 years. This is super easy, everyone can do it. Okay? And usually that's how we do. We just calculate the average historic return. Now, you can possibly calculate the compound return, and it's going to be slightly different. This particular is going to be 1.97. It's going to be almost the same. It's very, very tiny little difference. So, that's the average historic return. It's very easy to calculate. Whether you do the compound return, sometimes called geometric return, or whether you do the average return. So, how do we do the probability? Very straightforward. You make, it's called scenarios. You make scenarios, and let's do the scenarios for housing. If the economy is doing great, let's say the economy of Cambodia is doing great, how much do you expect your houses to be up? Real estate, let's say Phnom Penh.
In a year?
In a year, yes, in a year.
What's it going to be?
Plus 10.
2K.
Huh?
Not 5K. 5,000.
No, no, no. You got to do percentages.
Oh,
percentages.
7%.
Or 7%. If the economy is doing great, it's going to be 7%. If the economy is doing good, what do you owe? And we have to, right, plus 7. How much is the real estate?
5%.
Okay, oh, the economy is going to be doing 5%. If the economy is not doing good, but it's not really, really horrible. Oh, it's still going to be 2%. Wow, this is an amazing economy where the economy is going bad and real estate keeps going up, 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 and up. Huh? It's got to be one of the best investments in the world, right? Or, more likely, it's going to be one of the biggest real estate bubbles in the world. Anyway, well, can't be bigger than China. And if it's real bad, is in a serious recession, you know, things go wrong, whatever it, you know, all you need is just one bank go bankrupt, and then panic and chaos, and suddenly the economy shuts down, then what's going to happen with the real estate?
-4.
Okay, -4. So, these are the expected returns in each of the scenarios. Now, all we need to do for the next step is to determine the probabilities. Well, what's the chance of a horrible economy for this 2017, for this, for one coming year? What's the probability like? All right, let's say 10%. Hey, there's a 10% chance that China crashes and then the whole banking system, you know, everything. But there's a chance. Well, what's the chances of the economy going great? I don't know. I'd guess 20 or 30.
30.
All right, 30 it is. Yeah, we're all going to be happier with 30%. Well, the economy going real good, I'd say, is going to be 40%. I mean, things are going good. There's a very good probability they're just going to keep going well the way it's been going. And there's some chance, like 20%, that the economy might turn out to be bad. Not horrible, but the economy is choking, not doing great, you know, but not really horrible. Well, you do the return, you do the probability, you just add up. And then you do the total. So 7 times 3 is 2.1. 5 times 4 is 2. 2 times 2 is. Well, 4 or 0.4? Let's say 0.4. And next one is 0.4 again. 0.4 again. So, remember, most of it is going to be between 5 and 7. So what's the average? We call this weighted average. What's the total? 4 points. I calculate 9. Alright? You see, it's just about 5. There's a chance to be a little bit above, but there's also a chance on the downside. Well, that 4.9 is the expected return. We call these scenario.
So,
do
we calculate
the
minus
point? Oh, yes, 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 you see. Is that a bonus point?
No, she asked.
Yes, it's got to be minus. That's my mistake over here. And